Hey, good morning or good afternoon. I don't know what time it is in your side. But now, have you ever heard about the hidden manna? Have you ever heard that verse talking about the hidden manna in Revelation chapter 2 verse 17? I'm sure this one is something maybe some of you have heard. The Bible says, "He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the hidden manna." Hidden manna. Something is hidden here. "And I will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it." No, I'll not talk about the stone right now. I'll only talk about the hidden manna. Have you heard about that? So, guys, you have to understand, in part of Lord's message to the Church of Pergamum, the Bible tells us about something called the hidden manna. And the book of Revelation is basically just an example of apocalyptic literature. Okay? Apocalyptic literature, which features symbolism and sometimes bizarre imagery and in his presentations and prophecy. And the hidden manna, this hidden manna that we're talking about, which is mentioned to the letter of to Pergamum, is one example of such a symbolism. And quite simply, the hidden manna is a symbolic picture of Jesus Christ. Okay? I don't know if you have ever thought about this. It's just a symbolic picture of Jesus Christ. As the manna of As the manna of Exodus, you remember that manna which was given in Exodus, sustained and strengthened the Israelites for the 40 years in the desert or in the wilderness. So Jesus himself also strengthens and sustains us spiritually as we walk through this life on our way to heaven. Jesus is that manna from heaven. He is that manna from heaven. The scriptural sustenance we need, and it is promised to us. Now, you have to understand one thing, brothers and sisters, that Jesus in the Old Testament, he was hidden. He was hidden in different symbolisms, okay? He was that manna that the children of Israel ate in the wilderness. Jesus was the one. He was that rock that Moses hit, and it gave water, the water of life. He was the rock of ages. Jesus is the sheep, you know, that lamb which was sacrificed in the Old Testament for the covering of sins. You see, there's a lot of symbolisms when you look at Jonah in the belly of a fish for 3 days, okay? That is Jesus at the belly, at the bottom of the earth for 3 days and coming out to give the good news. You see, there's a lot of hidden symbolism of Jesus in the Old Testament. So the Old Testament is Jesus concealed, all right? And the New Testament is Jesus revealed, okay? So they all meet in one place. Jesus is the main focus of the book. And that's why the Bible tells us, Jesus actually was telling the people that they search the scriptures daily, thinking that in the scriptures we have life there in this book. People, they think life is found in this book. But the life is found in Jesus. That's why the Pharisees read the Torah. They knew a lot about the Torah. They knew everything about this word of God. But still, Jesus said, unless your righteousness surpasses the righteousness of the Pharisees, you'll in no way enter the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because the life is not found in this book. The life is found in Jesus Christ. These scriptures only speak about the life giver. Okay? The scriptures only speak about the life giver. So we need to understand that Jesus was that bread, that manna, okay? So when you look at this, we have to understand something in depth, that Jesus himself, okay, made the connection between the manna of Moses, that manna of Moses' day, and his own provision of salvation, okay, when he died for us at the cross. You remember him, Jesus, saying in the book of John 6:48, let me show you this, John 6, verse 48, okay? We'll read, oops, where did I just press? Okay, John 6:48, we see Jesus saying something here, okay? He's talking about himself. See this verse. He says, "I am that bread of life." Now you understand. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. You see, that was only symbolism. They ate manna. It was only simplifying, trying to show me who would come later on to give my life, to give my body. So your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. Me, you will not die when you eat of me. But only when you look at, can I fulfill the law? Can I do this and that? Can I maybe follow the Ten Commandments and maybe I love life? No, they did all that and they still died. But Jesus says, now I am the new bread. I am the bread now. I am the giver of life. They did all those things. They followed the law, but still they died. Now the law cannot save you. I am the one who can save you. You see what Jesus is trying to say here? I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh. You see? Which I will give for the life of the world. Jesus is saying, my flesh is that bread. And let's look at verse 58. See? This is that bread which came down from heaven. Not as your fathers did eat manna, they are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. You see, Jesus was hidden all through in different symbolisms. He was hidden. And that bread now will be revealed because he will give us life. Are you seeing this point? So that manna that sustained the Israelites was a foreshadowing of the sacrifice of Christ. The manna, which is mentioned in Revelation 2:17, the one that I just read to you, it's just another symbolism to Christ. And as a symbol, the hidden manna is not to be taken literally. You see, there are people who think, oh, let me eat Jesus literally, like the Catholics. All the time, they're always eating that small bread. They think, I'm pulling Jesus into some piece of loaf, a loaf of bread, and then I'm eating Jesus. No, it's not literal like that. We have to be very careful and be wise when you are interpreting this. In other words, Jesus is not speaking of something that we literally eat. Rather, the bread of life is something that we ingest in another non-physical way. We receive the benefits of salvation by what? By faith. Let me show you in John 1:12. Okay, John 1 verse 12. It tells us how we eat of this bread. If you want to eat of this bread, the Bible gives us the formula here. It says, but as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So how do you become a son of God? How do you eat the body of Christ? Through faith. Are you seeing the point? So it's so clear here, very, very clear, that the manna is hidden. In fact, it is given exclusively to believers in Christ. Only to them. Only believers will reap the benefits of salvation. No one else will be able to reap this benefit of salvation. The unbelieving world that rejects Christ will never know the joy and satisfaction of faith in Jesus Christ. They will never know that. And the recipient of the hidden manna is specified. They have been specified in Revelation chapter 2 verse 17, where I read to you, those who will have faith in Jesus Christ, they will eat of this bread, this hidden manna, okay? The one who is victorious, the one who overcomes. So, the overcomer is the one who endures in his faith. You are saved and you put all your trust in Jesus Christ. Of course, you can lose your salvation, but definitely that salvation has to be activated by faith. You have to have faith so that you can be able to gain that salvation. So that's very clear. So despite trials and hardships, overcomers are followers of Christ who successfully resist the power and temptation of this world. That's the only way you eat of that hidden manna. Are you seeing the point here? An overcomer holds fast to faith in Christ until the end. And then he demonstrates complete dependence upon the Lord Jesus through thick and thin. I want to show you something in 1 John, okay? 1 John 5 verses 4, okay? This one is a good encouragement to all people who are born again that they will overcome this world. See, It says, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. When you're born of God, when you're born again, when you're saved, you will overcome this world. There's no temptation which is heavier for you. You will definitely overcome this world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. We put our faith in the right thing, in Jesus Christ, then we overcome the world. Okay? See, verse 5, it says, who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? The moment you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and he died for your sins, he shed his blood for you, then, my friends, you have overcome the world. You're already now dead with Christ and your life is hidden with Christ in heaven and there's nothing to worry you about. Okay? Are you seeing the point here? So as we seek, as we are seeking to remain faithful to Jesus, living in light of his death, burial and resurrection for forgiveness of sins and resisting the temptations of the world, we are promised goodness and we are promised to eat that bread of life, which is Jesus Christ. The hidden manna from heaven will be ours. Even the world cannot understand how, but we will be strengthened. We will be sustained. Okay, the world will not understand. Hey, how are you saying you're eating something? You see, Jesus said that a man shall not live by bread alone, but by the word, every word that comes from the mouth of God. So that is that bread. You see, the word of God sustains us. It sustains us. And if you're still there and you're still not saved and you're not a partaker of this bread, my friends, you see, it's not about literal bread. You know, some people may be thinking, it's a big bash. Basically, you have to understand what Jesus tells you, that you have to be born again. And you may be asking, what do I need to do to be born again? What do I need to do to be saved? Now, let me tell you one thing, my friends. We are all born in sin. We are all born in sin. Adam sinned against God and all his children were born in his own image and his likeness of sin. Let me show you this verse. I always quote it all the time. Genesis 5, verse 3. See the children of Abraham, of Adam, how they were born. And Adam lived 130 years and begat a son in his own likeness. You see, the likeness of sin, after his image, the image of a sinner, and called his name Seth. So every child which was born under Adam, he was born in sin. So you're only just a sinner adding sin to sin. You never contributed anything to be a sinner. You're only born into this world as a sinner. So neither will you contribute anything to be born of God and be born again. All you need to do is just be born in spirit. And how will you be born in spirit? By faith. You see, the Bible tells us it is by faith that we are saved. Okay? You are saved. Once you are saved, because Jesus just came and died so that you can have his life. He just came and said, okay, these people are sinners. They have been born into this world as sinners. And their destiny is dying because the wages of sin is death. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to live a perfect life, be born into this world, live a perfect life, and die and take their death, and then they take my life. Simple. And how are they going to take my life? By faith. They just need to understand that I came and I lived a perfect life. I did everything for them and I died for them at the cross. And once they believe that, then they are immediately born in the spirit. Because they don't need to do anything. Just the same way, being born as a sinner, you contributed nothing. The same way, being born a righteous person, you contribute nothing. It will only be just by faith. Believe, and then you're born in the spirit. Believe in Jesus who died for you. Take his life by faith. That's it. All you need to do is understand that, and then you're born again. And then just confess to God what you've believed. Just tell Jesus, Jesus, I know that you died for my sins, you were buried and rose again. The third day, as is written in the scriptures in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Jesus, I receive this payment, this atonement that you shed your blood for me by faith. And voila, you're saved, sealed and sanctified unto the day of redemption. You see how simple is the gospel, the simplicity of the gospel. But people try to complicate it by saying, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to be a good person, I have to stop sinning, I have to give tithes, I have to do this, I have to do that. There's nothing that you need to do. All you need to do is just being born. And whew, you're done. All right, if you enjoyed this video, please give it a like. Also, you can share to your friends, let them hear the gospel. And also, likewise, you can also subscribe and check in the description below. We have a couple of other channels outside YouTube where you can be able to check and share to your friends. Let them hear the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. God bless you and have a good time.